We're so pleased to introduce Doyne and Corinne Moraz. And the reason we're meeting with them is because they really made an exceptional gift to the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. And I thought it'd be fun to really get to know them, a little bit about them. And so I'd like to start with Corinne. Now, I understand you're an opera singer.
That's where I started, yes.
And where did you sing?
In the Bay Area and Sacramento. I did have one fun experience in Edinburgh when I was preparing the Christmas program for Minotti. And I did not look anything like he wanted the mother's role to be in all in the night visitor. He was used to small, very statuesque German singers singing his mother's role, and here I came. But he was very kind. Our home has a large porch that goes around it, and it overlooks Ashland. And we have, for years, the reason we bought the home was that Doyne was bringing tour groups up for the festival and doing lectures, and it got to the point where our tour group was too large to give lectures to in the residences that we had put them into. We just had to, Joseph Doyne bought them a home. And so everything from that point on was done at the home. The Shakespeare Festival has been very good about providing actors to come in and talk to the tour groups and all of that. Their resources are extensive and they are generous with them.
Wonderful. Now, Doyne, I know you're a professor at Southern Oregon University. You're also an actor. I know you started the Los Altos Repertory Theater. Tell us about, a little bit about that, your background and the loves you have.
Well, theater all my life, since I've been 6 years old, beginning in the Depression, and with voiceovers and things like that in the city of Chicago. And I have found that to be my niche in life. So it was natural that when I went to school, I would follow the theater path. My parents, however, had another idea about it, and so I followed two paths in college, but finished with getting my work at Stanford and went to film school at the University of Southern California. So I'm sort of knowledgeable in both fields, except theater has been my great love. I found very quickly that I didn't want managers telling me what to do. I'm a little incorrigible that way. So I decided to start my own theater. And so I did that for 20 years. And what was interesting about it is I got a close friendship with Jerry Turner, got to know him, and he used to come down to Los Altos, to my theater, and buy actors from me so they could work at Shakespeare Festival. And I used to come up here and buy actors from him. So we kept actors, some actors, busy the full year, and that was before the festival was as big as it is now. Well, the love affair has been going on for 59 years, our first year of marriage. We were coming from Seattle, and we stopped to see this little theater that had benches outside in an Elizabethan configuration, and we had no money except to buy our last money we spent on tickets. And we did have a few pennies left over and a gas card. So we bought some crackers for the Swans, and we stayed for the whole show and drove all the way to Sacramento after that. And so that was our first association. And I said to Connie after that, let's go back and see what's happening. And so it has been really a tremendous love affair. Philanthropy, I'm not a philanthropist. I can't see myself as that. I love the word, but people, I just wanted to do this for the festival. My children did not want the house. They're spread all over. And I thought, well, what better situation to help a theater, and the theater that's dearest and closest to my heart. So it just was a natural kind of thing. I didn't think of it as a gift, except I got a wonderful tax write-off.
You, you know, just suggest to other people how they might give, how easy it is to give.
Oh, Well, it's easy to give if you have a great deal of money. I recall at my theater in Los Altos, people used to just come by and all of a sudden surprise me with a $100 check. Well, I thought that was absolutely wonderful. I never thought myself of doing that sort of thing, because I never thought of being a philanthropist. But when you think back over the years, and you think back what you're doing for the community, it is a measure of philanthropy to have a theater where people can come and enjoy an evening and enjoy your entire season. I will not forget, though, the Hewlett-Packard Foundation. Hewlett and Packard were actually close friends of ours, and they lived in Los Altos, and the Hewletts used to come regularly. Mrs. Packard was not happy because her husband did not like theater. He liked the symphony. So they gave money there. But I remember one day when Mrs. Packard came by, standing in the doorway of my dinky little theater, and she said, "I want to give you some money." And I was overwhelmed, and I said, "Well, that's very much appreciated." And so she handed me a check. And I thought it said $100. It said $10,000. She wrote a check from her personal account. Because Mr. Packard wasn't into giving money to theater. So that's just one piece of philanthropy. When a home is yours, and it's been yours for years, and you have really no outlet for it, I mean any viable outlet that's going to try to help people, give your home to the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. I have just found it a wonderful, wonderful thing. And the Oregon Shakespeare Festival doesn't get much. I got tremendous amounts. The rewards are unspeakable.
Oh, yes. Well, you know, it's a very different feeling when you're giving a gift, whether it's a house or anything else, than when you're taking the money yourself. We have never really felt that we needed to go a million places. We've been a million places. But now it seems to us a better thing to give a gift that will spread itself around. And when I see the children coming to the theater, or of course children are my thing, and it really touches me to know that we're supporting something that's going to be educating children. Many years.
Wonderful. That's just absolutely fantastic. Yeah, tell us about what is this Tennessee Williams story?
When, during the Second World War, my father had nothing to do with the military. Nobody in the family could figure out why. Well, we found out eventually that in Chicago, he worked for the Cuneo Press, which was the largest printing company in the world. And come to find out that printing presses are the easiest machinery to make munitions. So my father was making munitions for the war effort. As a result of that, we got to travel all over the United States on troop trains. And so one time we went to Key West, Florida. And my father had taken me to see the first New York performance of The Glass Menagerie with Lorette Taylor and Eddie Dowling. And I thought it was absolutely wonderful. It was the best thing I'd ever seen in my 10 years of life by that time. And so we went to Key West, and my father pointed a little house to me, and he said, "That's where the man who wrote the play lives." I said, "Oh, Tennessee Williams?" And yes. Now, remember, in the Second World War, children were not allowed to speak to adults. So I was forbidden to go there. But I took my guts in my hands, and I went to that house, timidly knocked on the door where raucous laughter was occurring. And I was afraid then, all of a sudden. And so I started to leave, and as I got to the front gate of this little white picket fence, I heard this voice, little boy, come back here right now. And I about died. But I went back, and it was Mr. Williams. And there were people inside the house, and, you know, just remarkable people whom he knew. But he said, I said, well, Mr. Williams, I want to tell you that I saw your play in Chicago, The Glass Menagerie, and I want to tell you it's the best thing I've ever seen in my entire life. And he said, you come in here right now. And he gave me a martini. And I left that place drunk, just drunk, as a little child. 30 years later, to the date, I was hired by his agent to direct the first production of the two-character play in San Francisco. And he had heard about my work with Faye Dunaway and John Voight doing Streetcar in Los Angeles. I had done work there. I was the dramaturg on that production. So anyway, he had heard about the work. He'd come in, he'd seen me, and saw how I worked. And this story is getting long. And then asked me to direct the play. I was deeply honored.
Let's talk about Southern University.
I was very fortunate. I retired, and the Dragon Lady said to me, after I was homesick for 6 months, you need to get a job. You're not going to be happy unless you have a job. So I applied at Southern Oregon University. It happened to be an opening, and they accepted me. And I was very happy about that. You know, after teaching for 30 years and retiring, then moving into an altogether different situation. I teach critical thinking, and each of us who teaches critical thinking does that process with a topic. So there are numbers of topics that are being taught. I chose Shakespeare, and I love it, of course. It's my heart and soul. So the students come to me, and I just looked the other day, my classes are all filled already, and we haven't come close to September. So I don't know what they're going to do about that. But I love teaching the Shakespeare. The students are just wonderful. There's something about a student who knows something about Shakespeare or wants to know about Shakespeare that makes them a part. For some strange reason, they appreciate literature, and that makes them more liberal, more open, less demanding, and more appreciative of all of the arts and of the giving that they see authors portraying for the world. Shakespeare gave to the world. He gave his life to the world. And we still have him, thank God.
So if you were to mount a production here, and you go back into all of your background, all the plays that you've, you know, participated in, directed, whatever, what play would it be that you'd like to
read? I would want Mark Murphy to play Hamlet again. Absolutely smashing. And I saw Cyrano de Bergerac 17 times.
Oh,
that's
God.
How many times I appreciated it. It was remarkable. And Jerry Turner did a wonderful production of Tis Pity She's a Whore. And I never thought that I would appreciate or like that play. And it just knocked my socks off. It was magnificent. And then small, Strange Snow in what was the Black Swan at that time. Absolutely memorable. I can never get it out of my heart. It was so overwhelmingly beautiful. And the Black Swan, of course, was absolutely wonderful. The Thomas Theater has replaced the Black Swan. I'm old. I'm partial. I love the Black Swan. I love the Thomas Theater. Don't get me wrong. I love the Thomas Theater. But the Black Swan, there was a poor lame duck swan. So I absolutely adored it. And the productions, they went so far to get those productions perfect. And they were. Almost everything I saw there, A Doll's House, almost everything I saw there was absolute perfection. My son was 6 weeks old when he did his first show.
So, I'm carried on stage.
No, he was in a pram.
Yeah. Separate tables.
Opening, second act of separate tables.
And crying on time like that.
Oh, well, you put a kid on in a pram, he's asleep, right? You bring the lights up, something's going to happen.
You never know what's going to happen.
Oh, my gosh. Well, this has been just fantastic. Thank you so
okay,
much.
Okay,
really
thank
appreciate
you. Thank you.
Being here.
You can get something out of
this. Oh, gosh, it's going to be wonderful.
Okay.